So you go to download some program and you see there's a couple options, a 64-bit version and a 32-bit version. But I mean, Windows is 64-bit these days, so why does the 32-bit version even exist? Should you ever bother downloading it? Well, I wanted to know, is there ever any reason to use a 32-bit version if the 64-bit is available? And to my surprise, turns out, yes. And actually, this means going forward, I'm gonna have to be considering, maybe I do wanna get the 32-bit version, actually, of some program, depending on what it is. Now, to be clear, I'm not talking about Windows itself. There's really no reason for using 32-bit Windows. What I'm talking about is the programs themselves, which Windows supports running both 32-bit and 64-bit. And by the way, if you see x86, that actually is talking about 32-bit. Don't get confused by that. So then, what are the differences between running a 64-bit version of a program versus the 32-bit? I'll do a quick rundown and then we'll get into the details. The two main differences are the amount of RAM they support and their speed. 64-bit programs support a lot more memory, effectively unlimited. You're not gonna run up against that limit. However, 32-bit programs are limited to just 2 or 4 gigabytes of RAM. It does depend, I'll explain that later. However, in terms of speed, it turns out that 32-bit programs can actually be significantly faster than 64-bit. And depending on if the program inherently does not need a lot of RAM, then it might actually be the better choice. Now, if you're like me, you might have seen people mention that 32-bit can be faster than 64-bit and thought that it's probably just negligible. But I actually wanted to know for sure, so I created a test program that does a bunch of different operations in a loop and compiled it in both 32 and 64-bit and then compared the differences, and it is significant. Of course, I'll get into how much and why this is too later. Now, there are some other differences I've read about. One is that potentially the .exe files themselves might be a bit bigger for 64-bit, but this seems to be negligible. And also another potential difference is the 64-bit version might have a bigger memory footprint in terms of like how much memory space it actually takes up, and that'll become clear why later, but again, this doesn't seem to be huge. Like, in the difference for my test program, the 64-bit version was 15.5 kilobytes of RAM versus 11.5. Now, percentage-wise, that's pretty significant, but for a bigger program, it probably won't make much of a difference. Now, at the end of the day, if you don't want to worry about it, just get the 64-bit version and don't worry about it. It'll be fine most of the time. That's the right choice. Now, before getting into the more specifics of the differences, something else that you shouldn't have to worry about is all your data being collected and spread online, which is where today's sponsor comes in, Aura. There are so many sketchy data brokers out there that collect and sell your information to scammers, spammers, and anyone else who may want to target you. I'm talking your full name, email address, home address, health records, your relatives' info, it's all out there. But that's where Aura comes in. For example, it can show me which data brokers it found that are selling my info and automatically submit opt-out requests for me. Cleaning up this info not only helps reduce the amount of spam coming my way, but protects me from hackers who might leverage this info to try and access my accounts or even do personalized phishing attacks. I was even surprised when it showed me that the collected public info out there even includes what kind of car I drive. But Aura also has a ton of other features, such as an antivirus, a VPN, password management, parental controls, identity theft insurance, all in one place instead of needing a bunch of separate apps. Even if you already have one or two of these tools, you could still be leaving doors open to bad actors. But Aura is always on, so you can have peace of mind and focus on the important stuff. So if you don't want to leave you and your family vulnerable, to get started, you can go to aura.com/theojo and start your 2-week free trial. Link is also in the description. And with all that being said, let's continue. All right, so let's talk about that first major big difference between the two, which is the amount of memory they support. Like I said, sometimes you'll see people talk about how 32-bit programs have a limit of 2 gigabytes, and other times you'll see it's 4. And why is that? And actually, it is both. It depends on how the program was compiled. You see, when you go to create or compile the program from the source code, there's a flag that you can set in the compiler called image file large address aware. And if you set this flag, and presumably you might have to add a little bit extra support in the code, then it will actually support up to 4 gigabytes of RAM. And if you don't set this flag, it is limited to 2 gigabytes. Now, this thing image file is not talking about picture type files. It's talking about image in the sense of like the binary file, the program file. That's what it means by image. And random fun fact, it turns out that you can actually, if you really wanted to, set the flag here to negative on a 64-bit program. By default, it's set to support it, but if you set it to false, that means that even the 64-bit program will only support up to 2 gigabytes of RAM, but you would have to like specially do that for some reason. However, for 32-bit programs, this flag is not set by default. So it turns out that most programs I've seen that are 32-bit are actually limited by 2 gigabytes and don't have this flag set. In Windows, there's surprisingly not really an easy way to detect whether a program is 32 or 64-bit. It's not in the properties window, but you can actually tell indirectly if you go to the compatibility tab of an EXE and then you click the dropdown for which operating system to try and use it based on. If it says Windows 95 as the top one, then it means it's 32-bit EXE, and if it says Windows Vista, then it's 64-bit. Out of curiosity, I wrote up a quick C# program that would like go through all the programs in a folder and check whether each one was 64 or 32-bit. And in my program files x86 directory, of the 800 in there, 75% of them did not have this flag set. So yeah, most of the time, it's going to be a 2 gigabyte limit of RAM for 32-bit programs. Now, why are these limits 2 and 4 gigabytes specifically? Without getting too technical, it has to do with how the computer stores the addresses in the RAM. On a 32-bit operating system, they use 32-bit integers for the memory address. And that just means that the amount of places you can address a single specific byte of data is 2 to the 32 power, which ends up being around 4 billion bytes or 4 gigabytes to be specific. On a 64-bit operating system, you have 64 bits to work with. And it's not simply double, it's actually exponential. So a 64-bit address can store around 18 quintillion different locations. That would be around 18 million terabytes of RAM, but that basically just means unlimited. Any limits that are in Windows are effectively just arbitrarily set. But just know that there's really no limit with this. Now, as for where the 2 gigabyte comes from, back in the day when it was 32-bit Windows, Windows actually split up the amount of RAM that was available to a program running to max out at 2 gigabytes for the user space, which was like how most programs were running, and then it would also have half of it to the kernel space. So basically, for a program running, half of it was used by the system for that program, and then half of it was like the program-related stuff. Not gonna get too much more technical than that. All right, so now onto the speed difference, which is probably more interesting. So I wrote up a C# program with the help of AI because I didn't know how to make these tests, but basically it just does a bunch of different various operations in a loop. And then I compiled it in 32-bit and 64-bit. It's just a drop-down setting in Visual Studio. And going off the results, it seems that basically all of the time, 32-bit is going to be faster to varying degrees. For some operations like this linked list traversal, it's really not much of a difference. It's like 1%, probably just margin of error. But you can see that for most of the other operations, it's like a 20% increase in speed over 64-bit. And then for the binary tree operations, which apparently are more memory intensive, that's like 40% faster, which is kind of crazy. Now, as for why this is the case, why it's faster, from my understanding, I'm not going to pretend to fully understand it, but basically, since the addresses themselves are smaller, that means that it's actually faster to work with getting the data and moving it around and stuff like that. And it probably does make more of a difference for a lot of little small operations where it's small amounts of data, especially for like repeated operations where you might be able to fit the whole thing into the CPU's cache, which if you didn't know is like way faster than the RAM. There's L1, L2, and L3, which usually is not a lot. It's maybe on the order of kilobytes for L1 cache and then megabytes for L2 and L3. And since the size of the addresses and stuff are half for 32-bit, that means you could probably fit more in there to have access to that way more faster. So for applications that you know will never need more than 2 or potentially 4 gigabytes of RAM, then you might actually want to go with the 32-bit if it's there. Of course, like always, I should mention this is a synthetic test. It doesn't always resemble real life. And potentially in most cases, it is preferable to have the extra RAM available than it is just being able to do some operations faster. However, at least it does mean that if you're going to look for a program and you're like, oh, it's only the 32-bit version available, it's so old, you don't necessarily have to be mad about it. You know, it's not the end of the world. might actually be the better choice. So with all that context, it kind of does explain why you still do see 32-bit programs. Like if you go into the Windows C program files, you'll also see that there's a program files x86 folder. And again, the x86 is talking about 32-bit, and there's actually a lot of programs that go into here. If you're wondering why they decided to make the new folder for x86 instead of 64-bit, well, basically, the convention in Windows is that the regular program files folder just gets assigned to whatever is the native architecture of that installation of Windows. For example, if you have the ARM version, like on this virtual machine I had that runs on the Mac, its program files has all the ARM stuff in there. It's not like program files ARM, though there is one called ARM, but that's actually for 32-bit ARM programs. So yeah, it's a bit confusing. So as for why you see a lot of programmers who offer both the 32 and 64-bit version of the program, I highly doubt that they're thinking about it as, oh, this one might be a bit faster if it doesn't need as much RAM. I think they probably just do it because potentially there's people on really old versions of Windows that might need the 32-bit, and also it's easy enough to just usually compile it in both versions automatically. It's not much more difficult for most programs. As for some popular programs that are only made in 32-bit, like I think Steam is only 32-bit, it probably, again, comes down to the fact that they probably determined that, you know, for their purposes, it doesn't make sense to introduce the extra overhead of development, as small as it might be, to have to offer two different versions if they don't need that extra memory overhead, if Windows is always going to support the 32-bit version anyway. And also, I'll point out that potentially they could just have like helper programs that maybe run as like a separate process for some parts that do use 64-bit or something like that. I don't know. So yeah, it's not necessarily that everyone should always upgrade to 64-bit. Turns out it is not as important as I thought. So I would be very curious to know what you guys think and whether you were as surprised as I was that maybe 32-bit EXEs are not as useless as you thought. So we can talk about that all down in the comments. Thanks again to Aura for sponsoring the video. If you want to protect you and your family's data and take advantage of all the other features it has, go to aura.com/theojo for a 2-week free trial. Link is in the description. Now, if you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is a really cool tool for image manipulation that you probably have never heard of before and does not use AI or anything, but it's still extremely cool. So I'll put that link right there you can click on. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.